One of the funny things about the Christian faith, and indeed about the Bible, is that it seems to be, as it were, designed that every generation has to chew it through afresh. We can none of us live on what was done before, because the culture is always changing, and that's always been so. Language is always changing. The pressure points for people are always changing. And again and again, and this is not just in our generation, every generation has found this, the way that people said things before seem to go stale on you. It's rather like the Israelites with the manna in the wilderness. You just have to go out and get the fresh stuff each day. And the good thing about that is it means that we all have to grow up, that there can be no passengers. We've all got to think it through, and that's the Pauline business about being transformed by the renewal of our minds. That has to happen. And the only way that that happens, I think, for most of us, is when we're faced with new situations which demand that we think through afresh just what is it that we say and what do we mean by it. We've got to do that. One of the funny things about the four books we call Gospels is that we don't know that the four people who wrote them thought of that title for them. It may be that because Mark in his first verse says the beginning of the Gospel, that people thought, Mark thought he was writing a Gospel, so that must be what they all are. But then actually as the second century and subsequently refer to those books as Gospels, what they're saying is this is the good news about how God did the thing that he'd always promised to do. And so the whole story of Jesus, not just the beginning and not just the end, the whole story is about something shocking and startling which bursts upon a world which was partly ready for it and mostly not ready for it in the first third of the first century in Palestine. So the whole idea of gospel is that this is a public announcement about something that has happened as a result of which the whole world is a different place, and everyone, but individually and corporately, is invited to discover that for themselves and to live within the new world that has thereby been created. And that's the good news. Of course, you can say it in a thousand different ways, but that's the story that all four of those books are telling. Something has happened by which the God who made the world has now fundamentally rescued the world from corruption and decay and everything else, and has invited all human beings everywhere to look at Jesus, the central character in this story, and to find in him and through him the way in which that new world has come to pass and that they can be part of it. I remember a long time ago now in the 1970s when we had one of those NEAC conferences and John Stott gave the summary speech and he said, people are always saying, what is the irreducible minimum gospel? And I remember him saying, I don't want an irreducible minimum gospel, I want the whole gospel. And it was kind of a wonderful rhetorical flourish. Now, of course, we all know that there are times somebody sitting on a railway train next to you suddenly says, is that book you're reading about God? Can you tell me about God or Jesus or something? And you've got 5 minutes before the next stop, what do you say? We've all been in situations like that, and basically you say a quick prayer and you go for it. But at the center of it must be Jesus himself. Not a theory, not an idea, but actually something about this person. Because, and I was just talking to a friend yesterday who said, here is this wonderful house which is the Christian faith. What's the front door? Where do people come and go? And the answer is, it is Jesus himself. That take Jesus away and you're left with a bunch of very odd theories which may or may not make sense to people. But the figure of Jesus himself always has been central and utterly compelling. And of course, it's to do with who he was. It's to do with the meaning of his death. It's to do with his resurrection particularly. But it's to do with the fact that in and through Jesus, the living God opened the great door of his new world, which he's been intending to make, and invited us all to come through it with him. And somehow to say that, and you can contextualize that every which way you like for the person who maybe only has 2 minutes to live or only 2 minutes beside you on the train, something about Jesus, something about what God did through him, particularly through his death and resurrection. Those are the things, however you're going to stitch it together, which want to be in that irreducible minimum. When Jesus says, repent and believe in the good news, towards the beginning of his ministry in Mark chapter 1, very interesting that there's an almost exact parallel to that in the Jewish writer Josephus, who's writing a little bit later than Mark, but not much later. And he talks about a time when he went to Galilee in the 60s of the first century, and he said to one of the brigand leaders, who was, we would today call him a warlord or something like that, he said, I told him to repent and believe in me. And what Josephus was saying was, give up your way of doing stuff, of war of national liberation or whatever. I've got a better idea. Come with me. And when you see it like that, you say, wait a minute, that's what those words sounded like in Galilee in the first century. When Jesus told people to repent, he didn't basically mean, in our sense, have some kind of very sad religious experience. It meant, you're going the wrong way. You're going to have to turn around because God is doing a new thing, and if you're going to be part of that new thing, you're going to have to give up the way you've been going. Now, I cannot imagine explaining coming the way that God is now going unless you also make it clear to people that they're going to have to give up the way they've been going, which is cultural as well as personal. It's societal as well as individual. It's the whole deal. It'll take a while to unpack that, but you've got to have both side by side. Repentance isn't the same as the good news. You could simply say to somebody, you're going to have to give up doing stuff the way you've done it, and then leave them to it. But if you're going to say the good news, it's always got to have the implication, this is something quite different from the path you've been on up to now. I take the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, extremely seriously. They are the heart of the biblical canon, and the biblical canon is the thing that we have, which is given to us by God, inspired by God. And in all four of those extraordinary books, in quite different ways actually, the meaning of the death of Jesus is directly related to the meaning of his whole kingdom agenda and proclamation, and vice versa. You can't get the one without the other. They go together, absolutely. Part of the difficulty of Western Christianity for the last 200 or 300 years at least is that we've split them apart, so that you have people who are simply focused on the cross and say, well, don't talk about the kingdom. That's either going to heaven or it's sort of social work or something. So we'll just talk about the cross. But you have other people who say, well, we're not quite sure about Jesus' death and resurrection. Let's just do all the being nice to old ladies and stray dogs and small children, and that'll be fine, you know. Don't give us all that theology at either end. The Gospels give us a whole picture, and we need that whole picture. We need to recover the vision of the kingdom without reducing it simply to social amelioration. The Gospels never do that. It's part of the fact that God is doing the new thing, rescuing the whole creation, rescuing his people, rescuing individuals of all sorts within that. And that happens through the cross, of course, climactically, but the cross as the climax of Jesus' kingdom work. We should never forget. Now, all the evangelists insist on this, that the words on the cross are Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. He's bringing the long story of Israel to its head. This is what it looks like when God becomes king. The church has often tried to implicitly split apart the way Paul did stuff and the way the Gospels do. In fact, some Christians today will say, actually, Paul is the one who gives us the Gospel, and then the four Gospels are just, as it were, the backstory. The irony of that is that that was the position taken by the famous German theologian Rudolf Bultmann two generations ago, exactly that, with the only difference being that he didn't mind whether the events happened or not, and the people who I've just described probably do for quite other reasons. Actually, the two mesh together brilliantly. Paul, of course, uses the word gospel, not that often, but often enough, particularly in Galatians it comes a lot. And when he defines what the gospel is, there are two or three different ways he does it. One is at the beginning of Romans, where he says the gospel is the announcement, basically, of Jesus as the Son of David, who, because of the resurrection, is the Son of God in power, and who now claims the loyalty and allegiance of the whole world. And that, incidentally, brings together the two strands. First, the Old Testament, where in Isaiah you have the gospel as the announcement that Israel's God is coming back to be king. Your God reigns, that wonderful song, that's from Isaiah 52, which is explicitly a gospel passage. But then Paul blends that very interestingly with what was going on in his world, where gospel was the good news that either Tiberius or Nero or somebody has become emperor. This is the good news. And for Paul, the good news is the Isaianic news, the news you get from Psalm 2 and so on, that actually the true God has become king in Jesus, and that therefore all the other kingdoms of the world are relativized. And if you're going to read Romans, you really have to start with chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. A lot of people just push that off to one side, but you shouldn't do that. And then in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul gives another account of the gospel where it's a narrative that the Messiah died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. It doesn't just mean one or two proof texts, it means as an entire story, the great scriptural story has reached its fulfillment in the saving death of Jesus and then in his resurrection. But as Paul says, without the resurrection, what's the cross about? Thousands of young Jews were crucified by the Romans in the first century. And without the resurrection, all it means is that's another dream gone west, you know, forget it. But because he was raised from the dead, that means that we can trust that his death had that saving meaning which Paul ascribes to it. So it's the whole package then, the whole story, which constitutes the good news for Paul. I had an email just early this morning from somebody wanting to take his study of Paul's theology to the next stage, as it were, somebody's a sort of master's degree level, asking me where it was all going, what should be about. And I'm afraid I gave him the same old-fashioned advice that I give to everybody. You just have to soak yourself in the scripture much more than you'd ever imagine doing, preferably in the original languages. And you have to soak yourself in prayer, and you have to listen hard to the cries of pain that are coming, whether from your next door neighbor or from people on the other side of the world. Jesus himself and the New Testament itself teach us that the way we get to know who we are and where we're called to be is through scripture, through prayer, through the sacraments, Jesus himself constituting these as the way of life for God's people, baptism and the Lord's Supper particularly. But then also the cry of the poor. In Matthew 25, Jesus tells us that's where we will actually meet him without even realizing we're doing so. And it seems to me that in each generation, there is no formula, there is no, hey, this is the book you should read and then it'll all be all right. Because God wants to do new things, but the people through whom he will do those new things are people who are Bible people, prayer people, sacrament people, and listening to the poor people. And somehow Jesus will come afresh to them and, please God, through them in ways that we can't at the moment imagine or predict, let alone control.